Welcome back. You're watching Hard Copy coming to you from our studios in Abuja. Senator Kabir Marafa of Zamfara Central Senatorial District is our guest tonight, and we're discussing the security situation in Zamfara State. If indeed what the government is coming up with right now are the solutions, why has it taken so long for the government to come up with solutions?
The state government is always quick to heap all the blames on the doorstep of Mr. President. I'm not here to defend the presidency. I'm not the employee. But I happen to have a very, very close relationship with the president. I know him. I have discussed this issue with him several times. And I know how he feels about this issue in Zamfara. And I know his intentions. But the fact of the matter is this. I am just a senator, one out of three from the state. And there are so many other people. When you are president, you receive information from everywhere. Now, there is a governor for that state. And when this governor, I'm sure the governor sees the president maybe 3 or 4, 5, maybe up to 10 times more than I do. People need to ask, what are you discussing with the president when you see him, the governor? Now compare the actions and inactions of Governor Yari, for instance, you know, with the actions and inactions of Governor Autumn of Benue State. When Benue State had these problems, we also saw how the governor stood and rise up to the occasion, invited all the sons and daughters of Benue State to Benue. They had a summit, you know, and they even dramatized the whole thing, making a casket of their dead ones, about 53 of them, and making it like a trend, you know, that draws attention of the whole world to what happened in Benue State. Have you ever seen that in Zamfara? Have you ever seen the governor did 1/10 of what he did during the primary elections? I'm sure you must have seen him insulting Oshiomhole, insulting INEC chairman, all because he failed to get what he wants from the primary elections.
Some people will argue that your governor has also, you know, hired vigilantes across the state. I think
when,
it has a...
When? This is another issue. When this issue started, largely it started between the vigilante. There has always been local vigilantes in Zamfara.
Yes.
Okay? So it started between the rustlers and the vigilante. Quite normally, because when robbers want to attack this place, the first people they attack, who? The security men, because they are the ones that are standing between them and their target. So at a point, Zamfara state government or governor came out to ban all vigilante activities, leaving the people open. When these 200 people were killed in a village called Ergaladima, a Moro local government of our constituency, the governor went there to ask, why did you hold this meeting? All this time, the government banned vigilante and everything. Then suddenly, when there was problem, 2019 was drawing nearer, and elections are coming close, we had the government again saying that they are going to, they now came out to say that each emirate should contribute or should recruit 500 vigilante groups.
So you thought, about you think it's political?
I have to not even think. I said it.
Yeah.
I said it also, that it is politically motivated, and we saw it.
Okay.
It was politically motivated.
Now, you estimate that so far 11,000 people have lost their lives. You are, 11,000 male adults have lost their lives. You're not counting women or children. You say about 44,000 orphans have come up as a result of the crisis in your state. You're advocating a presidential intervention fund. Why do you think that the existing mechanisms cannot take care of what is happening in Zamfara State?
There is already an existing problem. Zamfara State is overstretched. By our culture, our religion, and everything, we don't build IDP camps. What we do is, when there are problems with neighbors, you know, everybody expands, squeezes, you know, and accommodate, you know, the people that has problems. This has been our culture, and it has been there for a very long time. Now, the numbers are such that they can no longer, the communities can no longer absorb them. The primary schools can no longer absorb them. If you go to these crisis-prone areas, you see a single primary school housing more than 2,000, 3,000, 4,000, 5,000 IDPs. Who is there to take care of them? These people, this estimate that I made is a modest estimate. Zamfara State is in a serious problem. People are being killed. Nobody knows the number.
Are you optimistic that your proposal will be passed?
It has been passed by the Senate now, and what is left now is for us to push, you know, through the presidency to ensure that this presidential initiative on Zamfara State, you know, comes to being. And I'm quite optimistic that the Mr. President is going to do it, because we have seen it in other parts of the country, like in the Northeast, and it has worked very well. Mm-hmm. And what we said is maybe create an ad hoc committee, that is the presidential initiative on Zamfara State, and we call it PISAMS, and warehouse this 10 billion naira, you know, from 2019 appropriations to take care of these contingencies. Because if they are left unattended, the consequences is just better imagined. Most importantly, people of Zamfara must be allowed to choose their leaders.
Quickly, what do you say to those who say that they are disappointed in the leadership of the North? The protesters who went out on Saturday, you know, did not just complain about Zamfara. They complained about the North in general, and they say that their leaders have failed them. How do you respond to those people who say Northern leaders have failed the North?
That's a very tough one. But my training and maybe where I find myself, you know, always push me to speak the truth. Now, I quite frankly agree with them that, in fact, let me tell you my response to a question by a pressman when he asked me about leaders in Zamfara. I simply told him that there are no elders in Zamfara. If there are, they are either on sabbatical or they are on outright award. Nobody cares. Nobody talks about anything. Nobody. Today, if you are the governor of Zamfara, everybody would come and vow before you and nobody ask any question. Today, as I'm talking to you now, I'll give you just a very simple example of the failure of the government at the state level. Now, after all this protest and everything, the federal government came out, you know, with measures, with all seriousness. The acting inspector general of police went out. Number one, he created an operation codenamed, I can't even remember what he codenamed it, you know?
Bof Ada.
Bof Ada, thank you. Now, and he went out, sent notice that he is going to, I think, Kaduna State, Zamfara State, and Sokoto State. He was in Zamfara State yesterday. Where was the governor? Nowhere to be found. He was received by the SSG. Is that a measure of seriousness?
I hope you understand that when we talk about leadership in the North, we're not just talking about the governor of Zamfara State.
We are talking, yes,
it will
leadership.
Also include you as,
yes,
as a senator,
yes,
who is one of the leaders,
yes,
in the North.
Yes, I agree with you.
Do you agree that you have failed your people?
Well, I have, if that is the if that is the general consensus of the people. I know that I have discharged my responsibilities responsibly and to the best of my abilities, and I'm sure my people can attest to that. I speak for them. I speak to them even at the expense, you know, of sometimes my own life. Now, I know those are some of the prices you have to pay for leadership. And I told the people, I believe I am ripe for death. In fact, God has blessed me beyond measure.
Well,
I'm almost 60 now, and a second-term senator, and my people have done much more than I expected from them. When they voted me into office,
Senator,
yes, I beat incumbent. You know, there was federal government, state government, local government, all belonging to PDP. I was APP senator. I was voted in, and I have a duty to protect them and to come out and speak, even if
Senator,
that will take my life up.
But we have to also thank you for coming on Hard Copy. We hope that we
so
can
soon.
Have you a day, another day, you know, to talk about a number of other issues, because we know that there's also the Supreme Court matter. I mean, the matter which you won at the Court of Appeal, which has gone up to the Supreme Court. Hopefully, we'll be able to play host to you again sometime soon. Thank you for coming on Hard Copy today.
Thank you, Maope.
That's our interview tonight, but your thoughts are important to us. So please let us know what you think. kindly use the handles on your screen. Thank you for watching. I'm Maokwe Ogunyusuf. Good night.